A very good afternoon and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. We have no apologies today. And just before I start today's meeting, I would like to offer the committee's condolences to the family, friends and colleagues of David Hill, who was our colleague Jamie Green's head of office and who passed away suddenly this past weekend. Our thoughts and prayers are very much with you all at this difficult time. Our first item of business today is our second evidence session on the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Articles Scotland Bill. And I refer members to papers 1 to 3. So I'm very pleased to welcome to today's meeting Chief Inspector Nicola Robertson, Partnerships Prevention and Community Wellbeing Division of Police Scotland, Mr. David McKenzie, Chair of the Society of Chief Officers of Trading Standards in Scotland, and Julie Whitelaw, Interim Head of Housing, Customer and Building Services at West Lothian Council. And we very much appreciate the time that you've taken to join us this afternoon. So can I remind members to indicate who your question is for, and if you or our witnesses wish to ask or answer a question, if you just please type R in the chat box or request to speak and I will take you in. So we'll move now directly to questions. We have around about an hour and 30 minutes. So if I may, I would like to just open up with the usual general question and I'll perhaps come to, first of all, to Chief Inspector Robertson and then to David and Julie. And it's really just to ask broadly if you would outline your sort of organisational experiences, if you like, to date of dealing with issues around fireworks and pyrotechnic articles, and whether you feel from your organisation's perspective that the legislation is the right step at the right time. So I'll maybe come to you, Nicola, first.
Good afternoon, Convener and other committee members. My name is Chief Inspector Nicola Robison and I work within the Partnerships, Prevention and Community Wellbeing Division within Police Scotland. I have 22 years police service. Police Scotland has been working to address issues of the illicit use of fireworks and pyrotechnics for several years now, and obviously I've been aware of that throughout my career, and therefore obviously Police Scotland does welcome the introduction of this bill. Police Scotland's primary concern obviously is in relation to pyrotechnics and fireworks is the safety element, and obviously prevention through education and persuasion of using these fireworks and pyrotechnics responsibly is obviously something we wish a key focus on. However, we do understand that education and prevention efforts obviously may not persuade everybody to act safely within fireworks and pyrotechnics, and it's therefore essential that the officers have the necessary powers to intervene as early and safely as possible when these articles are misused. So we already have the existence of Operation Moonbeam, which is Police Scotland's response in relation to fireworks and bonfire night. So the onset of Halloween and bonfire season obviously has a significant impact on Police Scotland, and it's a marked rise in antisocial behaviour and violence, and it's obviously highly disruptive and potentially dangerous to the community as a member of the public and also our officers and fellow colleagues in the emergency workers environment. So this does have a significant impact on ourselves, and we actually now have a multi-agency prevention approach in response to this, which actually was on the back of a number of significant incidents that had occurred in 2017. Whereby officers in Police Scotland were actually injured, and primarily this violent behaviour was occurring in Edinburgh area of Scotland, and of course this was then preempted on the back of that, and it occurs every single year now with early planning and a multi-agency response in respect of bonfire nights and fireworks season in general. So it's hoped that the policy and kind of proposals around this bill can educate and persuade as many Scottish public to use these fireworks and pyrotechnics safely and responsibly, And obviously we're aware that there are several well-established religious and cultural events in Scotland where fireworks are legitimately used, and there are also many legitimate uses for other pyrotechnic articles. So we do obviously accept that. We've noticed in the recent years, obviously, there has been an increase in what is classed as a pyro culture in relation to pyrotechnics. And that's occurring at a number of different types of events, including music events and obviously football-related events. And that obviously is a significant concern to ourselves, because again, going back to, we want to ensure the safety of all the public attending these events and obviously the stewards who are stewarding them, and certainly my officers and other emergency workers as well. So I think they are the key points for ourselves in respect of safety. We absolutely do welcome the introduction of this bill if that's approved. And I understand that you have a copy of the illicit use of pyrotechnics at events in Scotland report, which hopefully will assist the committee in understanding some of the issues that certainly we face in respect of pyrotechnics specifically. And obviously a working group had been compiled within Police Scotland on the back of the issues with pyrotechnics. A lot of those issues are covered in that report. So that would be my summary at the moment, just in respect of, we do welcome this bill.
Thanks very much, Chief Inspector. That's very helpful. I'll bring in David next. But what I might do is come back to you just to ask a couple of questions around the offences and the potential for widening the offences, which I think you mentioned in your submission to the committee. But I'll bring in David, and then I'll bring in Julie. David, over to you.
Okay, thank you, convener, and hello to everyone today. Thanks for inviting me along. My name is David McKenzie, and I work for the Highland Council, but I'm here today as chair of the Society of Chief Officers of Trading Standards in Scotland, representing trading standards teams that operate in all 32 local authorities across Scotland. Now, our interest in this area is really about supply. It's about business supply and storage of fireworks. And among the very wide range of legislation that's enforced locally by trading standards is a number of pieces of legislation that cover fireworks, such as safe storage of fireworks, the prohibition on sale to underage buyers, and so on and so forth. So these new proposals add to that. And that's the area that we're particularly interested in, and that we have a particular involvement in. It's in, with regard to, you know, to generally speaking, retail supply and supply, you know, sale and supply and so on. And the sort of nuisance side of it and the sort of community behaviour elements of it are not really something that we're too involved in. I would say specifically in terms of the legislation, there's three things that we're looking at in terms of the bill. We're looking at, are the provisions that trading standards have to enforce, are they feasible, are they practical, will they work in practice? Second thing is, are the powers that are given to our officers, are they enough to make it work, you know, so it can be enforced and it can work in practice? And the third thing is, you know, will trading standards work on this, be financed and be funded? Briefly on these three points, I would say, to us, the provisions look feasible, they look good. We had quite a bit of input into this, made a number of suggestions, and drafters seem to have made a pretty good job of the things that, as I say, in terms of the supply, the business supply of fireworks, we're generally quite happy with that. In terms of the powers as well, again, we think that's generally been well handled. You know, there's no point in having laws if you don't have proper enforcement. You can't have proper enforcement without a suitable range of powers. And we think, generally speaking, happy to answer specific questions, but generally speaking, the fairly extensive powers that are there are enough for our guys to do their jobs properly. At the same time, they're not overly onerous on business, and there's protections in there for business in terms of you know, if in the event that the powers were used in an unreasonable or an unfair way. So that's the first two things. The third thing, will trading standards work be funded? Appreciate that's not a matter for the bill as such, but it's dealt with in the financial memorandum. And broadly speaking, we would say that we, you know, support a lot of the material that's in there in the financial memorandum in terms of supporting trading standards authorities to do this work. We had we're just completing an extensive programme of work for the 21-22 financial year for the fireworks provisions that came in last year. And that's been very successful. It's been very widespread, and it shows what can happen when when our guys are well funded to do the work and to bring home these policy objectives fully. The overall context of that, though, is of course that extra funding is excellent, and we really welcome it. But it can only be useful in the context of where local services are viable. And have officers with up to date skills and so on. The extra funding, it doesn't work unless the viable services are there and they continue to be supported. And it's been a challenge for a lot of local services in recent times, but it is a challenge for trading standards. But that's broadly speaking the three areas that we're looking at. Are the provisions feasible? Do we have sufficient powers, and do we have the funding to do our job properly? Mm-hmm.
That's great. Thank you, David. Nice and succinct. That's really helpful. So I'll just hand straight over to Julie. Julie, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. And I'd also like to thank you for the opportunity to speak to the committee today. I am the Interim Head of Housing, Customer and Building Services in West Lothian, and my service has a lead in relation to community safety and that engagement with community safety partners across West Lothian. And our organisational experience of the use of fireworks across West Lothian differs. However, we have had significant issues in relation to antisocial behaviour caused by the use of fireworks in pockets across West Lothian. And I think members of the committee visited Blackburn recently and met with members of the Blackburn Bonfire Night Action Group. This has been a really successful group. This is a group which has involved all of the partners across West Lothian, but I think it's important to point out that it really is community-led. So it was recognised that Blackburn was a hotspot, periodically it's a problem area, police were required to bring in extra resources to deal with it. So as a community safety board, it was agreed that some action had to be taken, and whilst the fire service pulled everything together for the first meeting, it has been community-led thereafter. So in terms of the legislation which is being proposed, we support the provisions of the legislation, but I suppose in considering the terms of the legislation, we consider that any action taken should be based on analysis of the data that's available, which is very much what happened in West Lothian in creating the Blackburn, the BBNAG as we call it. And in relation to firework control zones in particular, what would support the council would be clarity on the criteria and the thresholds to be applied. And we also have been quite concerned about the funding that may be required in terms of analysing the data, consultation and publicising any firework control zones that may need to be in place. But yes, the Council welcomes the introduction of the legislation.
Thanks very much, Julie, and I'm sure we'll come back to that point about firework control zones. And so thank you all. I'm going to just ask a follow-up question, and I'll just ask Nicola a wee bit about offences, and then I'll hand over to Katie Clark and then Rona Mackay. But Nicola, I wonder if I could come back to you. I noticed in the Police Scotland submission you touched on the provisions within section 7 of the bill, which are the relevant offences, the comments that have been made within your submission suggest that you would find it, or Police Scotland may find it, helpful to have a wider list of offences included in that list. For example, willful fire raising, culpable and reckless fire raising, just in order to promote a kind of more positive impact on community safety and well-being. And I just wondered, it would probably be helpful just to hear a wee bit more about the rationale for that widening.
Thanks, Convener. I think in respect of that, when we've looked at the kind of problem areas that occur in the incidents that we're having to deal with, we thought that that would be beneficial because there are some circumstances which doesn't actually fit the criteria for the legislation that's available at the moment. So it was something that we thought would be a consideration, if at all possible, moving forward, if that would be taken within yourselves, obviously, as a view of committee.
I'm just going to move straight on. We'd like to just touch on the main themes within the bill this afternoon. So I'll hand over now to Katie Clark, and then I'll bring in Rona McCallie. So Katie, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. And I'd be grateful if the witnesses could perhaps outline their views on the actual extent of the misuse of fireworks in Scotland, and whether they think that the legislation is a disproportionate response, as we've received a number of submissions suggesting that it, you know, this level of action isn't required. Could I perhaps start with Nicola and ask for her response to that point?
Yes, absolutely. We certainly think this would allow us further opportunities for that early and effective intervention to ensure the safety of the public and obviously ourselves as emergency workers. That although there are existing powers at the moment, these new proposals would obviously allow us to build upon that and almost give us another tool within our toolkit from an early prevention point of view. And I think that's imperative, that we want to look at the prevention aspect before these incidents obviously occur. So with that, and I would probably say that this is not just one single recommendation or proposal that will assist in that. It's collectively an element of each that will allow us obviously to improve on our enforcement and build upon what we can existingly already do. But we have established that there are gaps in current legislation, and this would allow us to fill those gaps.
And how would you quantify the current extent of misuse of fireworks? I mean, how much of a problem is it?
Well, what I would say is it's a particular issue which won't surprise you round about Halloween and bonfire season. I can give you a rough idea, which is building upon the stats that are within the illicit use of pyrotechnics at events in Scotland report. And we've actually refreshed those just to give you a more kind of current idea. So in respect of the number of incidents which have been classified under the Fireworks Disposal Code, I can tell you that obviously in 2020 and 21, there were 1,512 incidents recorded. And obviously for 2021 and 2022, that's actually reduced to 872. However, we have to take cognizance of the impact of COVID and obviously that a lot of events obviously weren't being held, etc. But that does appear to show some sort of reduction in respect of the amount of firework calls that we've had. However, I could also give you data in respect of the actual call volume, which you might find helpful for likes of Edinburgh Division, which is the one that is significantly affected during bonfire season. And of course, for the data that we've got here for 2020, which relates to fireworks, fire and antisocial behaviour calls associated with wider bonfire night, which we're taking into the period there of 30th of October to the 6th of November, that the amount of calls in November 2021 for fireworks was 649, and that in comparison to the previous year was 798, and obviously the number of fires that were reported in November 2021 was 105. Now those are only for Edinburgh specifically, so this has a real significant impact on ourselves, and I'd probably take back to any other opportunity or legislation or powers that allows us to do more in respect of prevention and the safety of the public. We would absolutely welcome any additional opportunity to do that.
And the Fire Brigade Union speak about the number of injuries to their members. To what extent are there injuries associated with some of these incidents?
I actually have that to hand as well. I don't know if it's included in our initial pyrotechnics report, but certainly I can provide. So in respect of health and safety reporting for Police Scotland, for the period of 1st of July to 2021 to the 31st of December 2021, obviously the quarter four data is not yet available, so we can only base it on the three quarters there. So that's added to the Q1 information that's already provided in the report that you've got sight of there. And it now includes accident and near misses for Bonfire Night 2021. So if the projection, obviously including the proposed figures that we expect from quarter four, it's likely to be broadly in line with the totals for 2019 to 2020. So to give you an idea of that, in 2019 into 2020, pyrotechnics at events, there was 25 incidents reported, and Bonfire Night fireworks, there was 3, and then obviously the total was 28. So looking at the projection for this year, for 2021 into this year, for quarter one to quarter three, you've got 10 incidents of pyrotechnics at events, Bonfire Night fireworks 11, which a total of 21. But by the time we take into quarter four, it will be broadly similar to those figures from 2019. And in relation to the specific reports of injury to police officers, we've obviously refreshed those figures as well, including up to December 2021, which bears out the potential for a large increase compared to the previous years, which was highlighted in that original report that you've got sight of, with one quarter still to be added to that. So the full year projection for ourselves will be 17 reports involving injuries for police officers as a result of misuse of fireworks and pyrotechnics. So at the moment we're sitting for 2021 for those three quarter periods at 13, but we do think that that projection will be 17 in total. And that compares to in 2017 and to 18, we had 2 reports. In 2018 to 19, we had 5. In 2019 to 20, we had 6. Obviously, the figures drastically reduced in 2020 to 21 because of the COVID impact, I would suggest. And that has now significantly increased to 3 times as much for obviously this period from 2021 into 2022, which obviously is very concerning for ourselves.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And could I maybe put the same question to David? Really just to outline his views on the actual extent of the misuse of fireworks and whether the proposed legislation is proportionate. Your perspective, David.
Yeah, sure. I mean, from our point of view, we do get some complaints about misuse of fireworks, but we don't get that many because people do tend to go straight to the police or perhaps to other parts of the council with those types of complaints. Our guys will investigate those complaints, and again, it's seldom the case that there's an issue with the things we deal with. So, for example, if it's perhaps something about under-18s abusing fireworks in some way, and there's maybe a suspicion that a shop sold it to them, we'll obviously check that out and, you know, do the necessary work that's associated with that. But generally speaking, I would say compliance is pretty high nowadays. Fireworks are explosive products, extremely dangerous. That's why we're sitting here having this conversation, I suppose. So it's something that the local authority trading standards do give a high priority to. Very strict rules about storage and, you know, movement of these things as well as their sale. Obviously Chief Inspector Robinson knows a lot more about this subject than I do, because it's not something we directly deal with. And the complaints that we do get, to be honest, once we've checked them out, we're tending to pass them on to the police anyway, because it's usually about an abuse and misuse situation away from the actual purchase or the storage or the sale of the product. Again, I would reiterate the point, though, that these are explosive products, and, you know, public safety is that most important. And so we would certainly echo that point, but probably not really for me to say as to whether it's proportionate or not as to what's been brought in.
Thank you, that's helpful. And Julie, could you perhaps respond from your perspective in terms of whether you feel that this legislation is proportionate given the actual extent of misuse of fireworks?
Yes, I think in West Lothian we have seen significant complaints in relation to antisocial behaviour which are related to the misuse of fireworks, and that is what led to the creation of the Blackburn Bonfire Night Action Group. That group now works to proactively plan for Bonfire Night as a result of the history of antisocial behaviour which is related to fireworks in the area, but that's not the only area across West Lothian where there are concerns, and already there is planning in place for Bonfire Night this year, looking at intelligence from previous years and planning, for example, diversionary events in these areas. So the view of West Lothian Council is that the legislation, particularly in relation to restricting the periods when fireworks can be used, will support the reduction in the incidence of nuisance associated with the misuse of fireworks, but also enable community partners, community safety partners, to plan diversionary events and enable members of the communities to plan and prepare for the possibilities of fireworks being set off.
Thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. I'll just hand straight over to Rona Mackay.
Thank you, convener. Good afternoon, panel. Just sort of in the same vein as the last line of questioning, I'd like to ask. We've heard about the damage and the antisocial behaviour and the concern around fireworks. And our previous public engagement, when we consulted with the public, there was a wide support for an outright ban on fireworks. And I'm just wondering what your response to that would be. If I could start with Chief Inspector Robison, please.
Thank you. I don't think Police Scotland would welcome an outright ban. I think we have to take cognizance, as I mentioned earlier, that a lot of people do enjoy fireworks, obviously safely in a safe environment. And for me, it's about encouraging the safe and responsible use of fireworks, and obviously through education, persuading people to go and attend at organised events which are safe, and everybody then will have received, on the back of the new proposed licensing system, people will have received training in that regard. So for me, I wouldn't support an outright ban on fireworks, and again, probably making mention of the cultural events and traditional religious festivals, etc., whereby fireworks obviously are enjoyed by obviously people at those events. So we would want to encourage the safe and responsible use of fireworks.
Thank you. If I could ask David the same question, please.
I'd probably echo those views I just expressed. I mean, from our point of view, we're very much focused on the fact that consumer protection is what we do. But, you know, we're also in the business of allowing businesses to operate fairly, safely, and make a living, sort of thing. And I think it's really important that the needs of business are taken into account here. Or as the Chief Inspector just said, you know, the legitimate public consumer desire to enjoy fireworks in a fair and reasonable manner. I think ultimately any legal product can be supplied, as long as it's supplied in a fair and safe and reasonable way, everyone can be a winner, if you like, from that situation. I think every different products have to be treated in different ways, and as I said already, fireworks are a particularly potentially dangerous, so that it needs more attention, it probably needs more regulation. But we would certainly we certainly think it can be done fairly and safely in such a way as to that legitimate businesses can continue and consumers can enjoy it in a reasonable way. I'd also echo the Chief Inspector's points about the cultural importance, various different communities within Scotland, and the role that fireworks plays. So, we do tend to, push our public towards organised displays and things. You know, we don't say don't buy out your own fireworks, and as long as they're allowed to buy them, that's fine. As long as it's done fairly and safely. But certainly, as long as there are appropriate and proportionate restrictions on those retail sales, that, along with various properly organised public displays and things, it seems to me that we can enjoy fireworks safely.
And Julie, would you like to comment?
Been said. But I would say that across West Lothian, many of our communities have gala days or Christmas parades, and they use fireworks to celebrate those occasions. So rather than support a ban, what we would support is legislation which would support sensible use of fireworks.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks, thank you very much. I'd like us to move on now to some questions around the licensing scheme. And I think, Rona, I'll maybe just come back to you, and then I'll bring in Pauline with a question, a supplementary on that. So, Rona, back to you.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. So it's proposed that this licensing scheme will involve a fee. And I wonder what your views are on whether that imposing a fee might lead to some sort of black market or online scams where the, you know, the quality and safety of fireworks is less assured. And, you know, is there scope for fraud here with the license? Could it be could the system be worked so that people who wanted to misuse fireworks could get it? Can I come to David first with that question, please?
Yeah, sure. I think I said in my opening remarks that we're generally happy with, you know, the way some of the provisions have been drafted, and we think they're broadly feasible. But there is a caveat there, and it's how some of the detail that's going to come out in terms of maybe regulations or whatever, in terms of how the licensing system will actually operate in practice, you know, those need to be done properly as well. And we certainly would welcome being involved in that discussion and contributing and assisting to that discussion. You talk about fraud. I mean, that is definitely a possibility, isn't it? And what we need to do here is we need to design a system which is as good as it can be, and avoids that, so that, you know, businesses who have to, if they only have to, you know, they have to check that someone's got a license, we have to have robust systems in place to ensure that there's a mechanism by which that can happen. I mean, for example, what we have at the moment, it's not an exact parallel, but for tobacco and vaping products and so on in Scotland, we've got, you know, clear system there for under, you know, for people proving they're 18 and over. And there's certain specific, you know, the passport and driving license, there's certain specific documents that are produced. They've got photos on them. You know, that sort of approach is probably what we need here. Obviously, those details are for another day, but that has to be done robustly and properly. And yeah, you'll never completely 100%, stop fraud, I suppose. But I think we can go a long way to doing that, and I think it's perfectly possible to set up a system which does all those things. In terms of the fees, always a difficult one. That will it create a black market? Probably, but we don't really know until it happens in practice. Clearly, some people are going to be dissuaded, I would have thought, from by a fee, and they may just not buy fireworks at all, and just not, you know, not look for fireworks, or they may look for illicit sources. And those illicit sources, there's a further danger that they're illicit, not just an illicit source, but an illicit product, you know, which might be an even more dangerous firework, because it's not going through the normal quality control and so on and so forth. On the other hand, you know, licensing systems have to be paid for, you know, they have to be funded in some way. And certainly raising some money through a licensing fee seems like a reasonable approach to that. So I think this is one area where, certainly from our point of view, in terms of the retail supply and so on, quite a bit more work is necessary on this to get these things right and to create a system which is as good as it can be. But I think that can be done.
Thank you. Can I come to Julie, please, with a slightly different question on licensing? Do you feel at this stage you have enough detail about how this is actually going to work in practice? I'm keen to know whether you think that, like, for example, I can imagine in my neighbourhood, you know, there could be hundreds of people applying for a licence to use on or around Fireworks Day. And, you know, that would seem to me to be quite labour intensive. And I'm just wondering, do you have the staff resources to do it? And, you know, has the kind of detail on how this is going to work practically been negotiated with yourselves and other local authorities?
I think the answer to that is no at this stage. So we're not clear exactly how the licensing administration would operate, and therefore we haven't had the opportunity to consider the resources that we would require to take that forward. So, you know, obviously we would need to know what the application process is and how that's to be administered. I think we just don't have enough information at the moment to properly identify what the administration of the licence process would be. And I think that when that is agreed, there would need to be a lead-in time to allow us to review the systems that would be used, the processes, the you know, any appeal processes or anything like that that would be required to allow us to identify appropriate resources.
Okay, thank you. Chief Inspector Robson, I don't know if you want to comment on those questions. Feel free to comment if you want.
Thank you very much. I would probably just say, obviously, can't really make much comment in respect of the fee aspect, but in respect of the proposed licensing system, absolutely, we're working collaboratively with Scottish Government in respect of that proposal and how that would look and how that would be worked through in respect to processes and any risks that were identified. Clearly, as has already been mentioned, absolutely taking cognizance of risks, potentially like fraud, absolutely need to be worked through to ensure that this system is robust and obviously delivers on what we require it to deliver to. At the moment, obviously, those considerations are still at the stage of whether that's going to involve a manual input of data or whether it's going to be automated, but certainly we'll continue that collaborative work with Scottish Government and other partners to ensure that that system is fully robust and obviously serves everything we require it to do.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Rona. I've got a few supplementaries and a few questions just around this this subject. I think, Pauline, you would like to come in with a follow-up on these questions. I know that Russell and Jamie would like to come in, and then David. So I will come to you all and start off with Pauline.
Thank you very much, Convener. So far, from the evidence I've heard, we can fully understand why everybody opted for a licensing scheme and not a complete ban, for the reasons I think Chief Inspector you said and others have said. You don't want to spoil people's enjoyment. But there are still pretty serious social antisocial behaviour incidents that we're really trying to get under control here. One of my main worries is that so far it seems quite complex. So you've got certain days that you can't use fireworks, certain times you can't use fireworks. So the public would need to be clear, because they're the ones you're relying to report to you that there's been an offence. So that's one of my first concerns. Like Rona Mackay has been saying in her lines of questioning, and I'm not favouring a ban, but I do ask myself, would a ban not be easier to police? Because this seems pretty complex to me. And so that's my first question is to Chief Inspector Nicola Robson. How confident are you that, given the complexity of a licensing scheme with all that's been said, that this will actually tackle the antisocial behaviour element of misuse of fireworks?
Thank you for that question. Obviously, I would say that this is where, from a Police Scotland perspective, the communication and the raising awareness of obviously this bill, if it is approved, is absolutely vital and crucial. We need to make sure that the public are left in no doubt as to what these new what this new legislation means to them. And I think that would require a multi-agency response and ensure that that is completely robust, that people are left in no doubt as to the clarity of what dates they're allowed and what times, etc. So I think for me that is one of the most important things. How confident am I in respect of the tackling antisocial behaviour element? Again, I would draw back to something I mentioned earlier, that this isn't about each component of this proposed bill in isolation. This is collectively using the implementation of no firework, of firework control zones, of obviously the licensing system, of the new stop and search powers collectively to respond to this. And I think that will have an impact and reduce antisocial behaviour. But absolutely, we do recognise that that isn't going to stop everybody. And that's where, again, I would go back to the education perspective of the raising awareness, making sure that that's put out in the right manner, the right prevention opportunities from ourselves, whether that be through processes that we do, like the pitching in programme, which we do with young people, which addresses a number of issues, and we can build that into this to raise their awareness of the actual impact and the dangers of using fireworks and pyrotechnics. So I think it just provides us a lot more opportunity, and I think that ultimately would reduce antisocial behaviour. But absolutely, this is not going to be the complete cure, but it certainly is going to assist us. But communication and the multi-agency approach is vital.
Yeah, I think that's a really helpful answer. So not to cross over into the, I know there's some members have got questions around the exclusion zones, but it seems obvious to me that given what you've said, that the only way this can work to use our quite as complex rules in the licensing scheme and to try and use it to control or stop antisocial behaviour. So in where I represent the City of Glasgow, Pollock Shields is notorious every year, and I'm not confident, I have to say, that all those cases are being prosecuted. There's another issue here about reporting. So would your understanding be that that's the kind of area where the exclusion zone might be used? Because if it's not, well, then how are we going to use this legislation to home in on what in some communities is a serious misuse of fireworks beyond the 5th of November?
Well, obviously, in respect of the implementation of the firework control zones, it will be local authorities, through engagement with our local communities, who will identify where these zones will be, and obviously they'll decide on the size, location and duration of these zones, absolutely supported by ourselves, but that is to do with engagement with communities, and these zones will be implemented if the community raises significant concerns, and that will be in response to those concerns. So obviously for Police Scotland, we'll support implementation of these zones, but the local authorities, through engagement with their own local communities, will obviously be the key as to where those are implemented and how many are implemented in each area.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much. I'll move straight over to Russell, and then I'll bring in Jamie.
Thank you, convener. This is a question, I think, for David, and it's two parts. The first one is, fireworks are obviously inherently dangerous, but in one of your answers earlier, you spoke about black market fireworks, the kind of stuff that presumably does not go through the same safety checks as what you would buy in a supermarket, for example. Can you in any way quantify how much of these types of fireworks typically you might seize? And secondly, given that a licence seems likely and it will cost money and will presumably become a barrier for some people to purchase fireworks, is there not a risk that it then leads to criminals exploiting that barrier and, you know, making the prevalence of these types of black market fireworks more common? Just whether there's any work done on that or any view on that. Thank you.
Okay, yeah, thanks for that question. I think, to be honest with you, we don't come across much in the way of, I mean, I talked about illicit and illegal fireworks, you know, illegal being, you know, a firework that's just, it's not constructed safely, you know, or we don't know it is because it hasn't been through the proper quality control. And an illicit one, which might be a perfectly proper firework, but it's just been supplied in a way that's not permitted. And certainly, that is more, we see more of that than we do of the, you know, the dangerous stuff and the fully black market stuff. It really is hard to predict how that's going to see. We don't see a lot of that. We've done some preliminary work this year for the Scottish Government on this in terms of looking at, you know, social media sites and so on. And that's very much in its early stages, but we don't think there's an awful lot of supply goes through that route, because a lot of the social media sites will you know, have a complete ban on the supply of that type of products, you know, through their trading groups on social media, albeit that people can get round that and do get round it from time to time, but generally that has that kind of effect. I think what's probably more likely is illicit supply, as I say, you know, supply that isn't permitted, at times of year it's not permitted, and as soon as you get out with the parameters of control, more and more things could potentially go wrong. What we have at the moment is we have a largely compliant industry with this in this field, you know, partly because of the work that, you know, ourselves and others have done over the years and keeping a kind of tight lid on it, if you like. You know, there's not many suppliers of fireworks now, and not many shops sell them. You know, when I started in this job 30 years ago, there were, you know, every corner shop sold fireworks. That's not really the case now. And, you know, I think there's certainly a risk, and there's certainly work for us to do here in terms of, you know, where this goes. And, you know, both these situations, the illicit and the illegal, very hard to predict, particularly in terms of the illegal, but it's definitely a danger. And I think that, so the short answer to your question is not very much research has been done on this, and more needs to be done. And that's certainly something that we'll be looking at.
Okay. And I suppose this leads on from that. And even though I think in our agenda sort of running order, I'm perhaps jumping ahead slightly, but you know, you as a public service within 32 local authorities, there'll be a cost attached to policing this. You've specified about the particular time of year around Christmas and New Year, which might involve public holidays, but do you envisage this creating a significantly greater workload for your trading standards people across the across Scotland? And if so, how can that be addressed?
Well, it will result in significant extra costs, there's no doubt about it. But if we were funded in 21-22 to carry out a fairly extensive programme of work on the, you know, the stuff that came in last year in terms of the times of day that fireworks could be sold and the maximum explosive content. We did a lot of good work on that, and it shows what can happen if we do get some decent specific funding. But you know, that needs to continue for that work to be done, and for that return, for that enforcement to be done, which is the only way to ensure that, you know, provisions are being complied with and the, you know, the intentions of the legislation are being achieved. It has to be paid for, you know. So there are significant extra. I mean, local authority, you know, there are 31 services across Scotland, one joint service across the 32 authorities, all fairly small, very wide range of varying obligations, and you know, they basically have to prioritise, and it's a challenge. It's a challenge to do that. But if there is specific, as I said at the start, if specific funding can come in for something like this, and it's in a context where our services continue to be viable, and you know, they're at the stage now, some of them, where they, you may argue, are they viable or not? They're certainly at risk of not being viable. But if they are viable and the funding comes in, it can work. The other point I'd make about this is, with this type of legislation, very often what we see is a real, you know, splurge of activity in the first 2 or 3 years can really sort something like this out, and it can mean that the longer term enforcement obligations are significantly less, you know, because there's been that positive engagement with the trade and, you know, the advice and so on, and they come to terms with what they need to do and so on. And generally speaking, there's less need for a specific new thing like this in the future. And the costings that are in the financial memorandum, I think, reflect that point as well.
Thank you. Just out of curiosity, more than any big bit of evidence, but which of the two local authorities that currently work together on this?
It's Stirling and Clackmannanshire work together. There's a joint team there, but that, you know, it's a relatively small arrangement. I think it was only one or two officers from Clackmannan when they joined up. But all the other authorities have their own train standard service.
Sure. Thank you very much. That's me, convener. Somebody else wants to go.
Thank you very much. And I'll just hand straight over to Jamie.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon to our guest panel today. I had two questions. One, I think these questions are probably directed towards the local authority, and I'm sorry to pick on you, but I think you're the only local authority that we're taking evidence from specifically, just due to the nature of trying to squeeze in the evidence sessions. The first one is, how realistic do you think it will be to get a scheme like this, specifically the licensing scheme, up and running this year? The government has quite an ambitious timescale to get these restrictions into place by this year's bonfire night. We have expressed a little bit of disquiet and discomfort about that. We want to get the legislation right. But actually, the licensing scheme, we don't even think will feature in the primary bill and will probably be subject to subsequent regulations that we'll have to look at as a committee. Given that there's so many sort of known unknowns and we don't really know the detail, and how quickly do you think local councils will be able to get these schemes set up if they're the ones that are required to administer them in time for this year's bonfire? Now, how realistic is that, and will that come at any cost, either financial or resource, to you? And do you think you have enough ability to meet the demands that may be placed upon you in the coming months?
I think it will be really challenging to have a licensing scheme up and running in time for this year's bonfire night. There would need to be some agreement on timescale for application, which community safety partners are going to be involved in advising on the application, the systems to be used, the criteria and the processes. So I think until all of that is known, I can't even answer the question in terms of whether we have sufficient resources and whether we would be able to divert resources from other licensing schemes to support this particular licensing scheme. So I think lots of the details still required before I would be able to confidently say we could have a system up and running. I suppose the thing to bear in mind is that with most licensing schemes, there is a sufficient lead-in period in terms of the date by which the application must be made to allow it to be processed. With a new scheme, there's always a little bit of to-ing and fro-ing with an applicant to make sure that we have all sufficient information, and that we are able to consult with advisers, and advisers need to have plenty of time to review that as well. So at least 28 days before the application was to be granted. If we are looking at restricted periods for fireworks to be used, I could expect that there would be a bit of a flurry of applications coming in at a particular time, which would be challenging again to manage. And there will also need to be sufficient publicity to members of the public to ensure that they're aware of the requirement to apply for a licence, the timescales for applying for licences, and the processes for applying for licences. So I think, from a local authority point of view, very, very challenging to have all of that in place for this year.
Yeah, that's really interesting and very helpful. Thank you. And I suspect they don't want to put words in their mouth, but I'm sure other local authorities and indeed COSLA might have some similar comments to make. But we'll hopefully get that feedback in due course so that we can help inform our stage one report. The other question I had related to that is, obviously we're looking at nationwide legislation around restrictions of the sale and purchase, but if you look at other schemes that we devolve to local councils, such as low emission zones or the workplace parking levies and other types of schemes that you would be responsible for versus the government, the legislation being the enabler of you being able to do that, how much flexibility would you like to see as a council within things like timescales, around the period of usage, around for things like exemptions and exceptions? So, you know, you could maybe offer enhanced flexibility in your own local area that meet the needs of your communities, whether it's specific religious groups or local events. So, in other words, is it better that we build a national scheme that you administer locally, or do you think this would work better as 32 separate schemes that had enough flexibility within themselves?
West Lothian Council would support a national scheme where there was an ability to have a consistency of application across all local authorities. And the reason for that is that we're likely to have, or there is a likelihood that there may be individuals who would wish to use fireworks across many different local authorities. And our experience is that with different licensing schemes in place for other processes, there's a lot of confusion amongst members of the community in terms of when they have to apply, what they apply for, and what the process is. Having said that we would support a national scheme, we would also support a degree of flexibility within some very clearly defined criteria to allow exemptions to be applied, for example, for gala days or for other social events.
Right. OK, yeah, that's great. Thank you for that. That's all for now, Convener.
Thanks very much, Jamie. Just to come in on those questions and answers, and just for the record to clarify, it's just to say that the government plans around licensing are for that to be in place by November next year. The plan for this year is that it's only proxy purchase for under 18s that they're looking to have in place by November 2022. So just for clarification around that point. David, I think you were looking to come back in, but I don't know if you still want to come in with a comment or another point. Can I bring you back in, David?
Yeah, yes, thanks, Convener. Just briefly on the licensing issue, certainly my understanding is that it's a national scheme for the license for a buyer, you know, to buy fireworks. That's going to be a national scheme, and that's certainly something that we would strongly support for consistency and for it to all be in one place and all and so on and so forth. And obviously the whole issue of firework zones and that is separate, isn't it? And that's the one that's more challenging and needs to be done locally, as colleagues have said. It's just to make that point. Sorry, that's obvious and it's maybe been covered already, but certainly from our point of view, we would need, in order for the sale only by licence, apart from exemptions, for that whole thing to work in practice, the licensing system has to be set up well, and we would strongly recommend that to be a national scheme that's clearly uniform across Scotland.
Thanks, David. No, it's helpful just to get that clarification on that point, so thanks very much. Okay, I think we'll move on now to looking at the restrictions around the use and supply of fireworks. So I'll bring in Fulton McGregor first of all, and then I think Russell Finlay maybe has some other questions. So Fulton, over to you.
Thanks, Convener. I'm just waiting for my camera to go on there, and good afternoon to the panel. Thanks very much for your thoughts and contributions so far. As the convener says, my questions are around the restrictions on use and supply of fireworks. So the bill, as you'll know, introduces various restrictions on the days and times when fireworks can be sold and used. And the committee's had some concerns about that, and we're looking for a wee bit more information that might alleviate those concerns. So I'm wondering, happy to take in any order. If as witnesses you're content with these proposed restrictions, do you think that they strike an appropriate balance between allowing people to enjoy fireworks and obviously reducing the misuse?
Can I bring in Nicola to kick that off?
Yes, absolutely. Thanks, Convener. From a Police Scotland perspective, we would welcome the clearly defined dates and times for the purposes of applying the proposed legislation. And in that, we're encouraging that public obviously plan early in respect of those people who do intend to legitimately use fireworks and pyrotechnics, that they consider the application nice and early, obviously, and it's a case of the encouragement of the planning for these proposed events.
Thanks. Is anybody else wanting to come in on this question just now? Well, I can perhaps move on and then maybe bring in yourself, Julie, if you want. I know that my colleagues who visited Blackburn have heard some support for local flexibility within the bill. That could encompass some of the stuff that we've been talking about on committee, which might be, you know, local gala days or local sporting events, etc. that might be important to people within a certain area. Is that something that you would support, or having that flexibility? What's your thoughts on that? Maybe if I could start with Julie.
Thank you. You know, as I said, whilst we would support a national scheme, we would also support some degree of flexibility for local authorities to manage exemptions, for example, for gala days or for local events. Our view is that the criteria to apply those exemptions should, however, be very clearly set out to avoid any confusion for members of the public, but also to avoid a flurry of applications coming in which would, you know, have no prospect of success. So yes, whilst we would support a national scheme, we would also support a degree of flexibility for local authorities.
Thank you. And I think David's looking to come in as well. I see you on the chat.
Yes, partly on your last point and partly on this point. I mean, again, our role is to do with the sale and so on. And, you know, we are very aware of this need to balance the legitimate interests of business with legitimate interests of consumers and particularly safety in terms of this topic. But the banning of sale out with the particular days will have a significant effect on businesses who sell fireworks all year round, and that needs to be taken into account. And it has been in the bill documentation, and we would certainly urge that the legitimate interests of those businesses are very much taken into account. But in terms of the legislation, again, we would seek clarity, and if for an order for it to be feasible to be enforced in a way that can be done well, you know, these particular days do that, and they do take account of the cultural significance of Bonfire Night and of the other celebrations that are recognised in there. So it's certainly we think that can work in practice.
Yeah, I'm glad to hear that. But do you think that perhaps by government or Parliament, if you like, picking the dates, suggesting the dates does open up the bill to criticism of other religious festival dates or dates that might become important in the future at some point? And I suppose what the committee is grappling with is, the more panellists that I've certainly spoke to on this issue, the more content I am becoming with the provisions in the bill, because it does seem to have a widespread support from stakeholders. But I guess as a committee, we're also grappling with, is it best not to have any dates at all? And therefore, you're not going into that minefield of picking the most important dates, because that will be different for different people. Or do we need, as my previous question asked, more flexibility for local authorities, for them then to be able to judge to local need? And I know I've already asked that question, but I guess I just wanted to set out where I'm certainly coming from with these questions just now, and I think other committee members are the same. But that was more a point than a question there, convener. I'm well aware of that, and I'm well aware of the time, so happy to pass back to yourself.
Okay, thanks very much, Fulton. Russell, I think you might want to come in at this point.
Yes, thank you. I suppose this does lead into the area that's kind of next in the running order about firework control zones, and I suppose it's a question primarily for Chief Inspector Robertson. Earlier in the consultation process, it was proposed there would be no firework zones, which has evolved into firework control zones. I just wonder whether, from a policing perspective, no firework zones would be a lot easier for people to understand and a lot easier for you to police.
I think from our perspective, that would go back to the communication and awareness raising that would be put out to the public so that they've got a clear understanding. And I understand, obviously, that decision was made to reword that, and we would have no objection with the fact it's been reworded to firework control zones, as long as the communication is providing full clarity to the public so that they appreciate exactly what that actually means.
Okay. And perhaps the same question to either of the other two witnesses, if they've got a particular view on it.
David or Julie, would you like to come in on that?
I'm not sure I can have anything strong to add on that. More a question for that one, I think.
That's no problem at all. Don't worry. Russell?
No problem. No, that's fine. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Katie Clark, I'll bring you in now. I'm aware you've got a question around imports, so over to you.
That's right. It's really a question for Police Scotland to ask them to outline the approach that they would take in relation to the importation of fireworks. I suppose the most obvious example would be people buying fireworks in England and bringing them over the border.
Yeah, absolutely. That is something that obviously we're considering whilst we're working through this new proposed legislation and also the supply of fireworks to businesses within Scotland to address out with Scotland, obviously, about residents that they might purchase fireworks from out with Scotland is also an area of concern that we're working through. Obviously, if there were issues moving forward, that would all be intelligence-based as to our reaction to that and our response. But obviously, it is something that we are considering.
I mean, would you be able to share any information with the committee once you are further ahead with your thinking? Perhaps in writing,
yeah, absolutely.
You're able to share more at the moment. Yeah.
Yep, absolutely. Obviously, it is something that we've got consideration for at the moment. I would probably imagine it will be a similar to response of that during the COVID, the impact of the coronavirus pandemic, when obviously there was suggestion of people might cross the border when the restrictions were in place. So I'd imagine it'll be something very similar to that. But absolutely, I'll keep the committee cited on any developments for that.
Thanks, Katie. Thanks, Nicola. I've got Rona Mackay and then David McKenzie wanting to come back in. So over to you, Rona.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, it was just a question I meant to ask earlier. It's on licensing again. So it was about the initial proposal that the licence would be valid for 12 months, but it's now intended that it could be for 5 years unless revoked. Can I ask what your views are on that, you know, given that 5 years is a long time and lots of things can happen, you know, someone may have a criminal record during that time, etc. Can I ask maybe Chief Inspector Robson first, please, and then go on to David and Julie.
Again, this is where we would want to discuss and work through collaboratively how the licensing system is going to work, and obviously for anybody having relevant convictions within that period, how that's going to be reviewed, and obviously to ensure that there's nothing that's missed through that. So that would be through that continued collaborative working with Scottish Government.
Thank you. David, do you have a view on that?
Yeah, I'd probably just echo what the Chief Inspector said, to be honest. I mean, 5 years seems like quite a long time. On the face of it, 1 year seems quite short, doesn't it? And I appreciate that if there's a longer spell, there could be robust provisions in there to take account appropriately of things, you know, as you say, things that happen, people gather convictions or whatever in the meantime. But a fair bit more work needs to be done on the detail of that, I would have thought. As I said earlier, as does everything surrounding the mechanics of the licensing system. So quite a good bit of work to do on that, but I think it can be done properly.
Thank you. Thanks. Julie, would you like to comment?
I think that, as has been mentioned, the mechanics of the licensing process would need to be clarified. With all licensing processes, there's a requirement to notify the local authority or the licensing authority where there's a relevant conviction, and that would need to be part of the process. So there would need to be some confidence in that being sufficient to manage any circumstances which occur during the 5 years.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks. Thanks very much. I'd like to just pick up very quickly and go back to the questions that Katie Clark asked around importing essentially fireworks from, say, south of the border. And just related to that, I wondered if any of the panel have views on the sort of risk that that might link with in terms of stockpiling ahead of, say, bonfire night, for example. And it's something that we have had a little bit of evidence on around that potential risk. I just wonder, I'll maybe come to Chief Inspector Robertson first, and then I'll maybe come back to David on that. So, Chief Inspector, just ask any comments on that.
Thanks, Convener. Obviously, this was something that we had identified under Schedule 1 of the paragraphs 25 and 26, which covers the supply of fireworks from businesses within Scotland to addresses out with Scotland. And of course, it's appreciated. I think there may be reference to it in the policy memorandum about existing enforcement already in place for the importation of goods, but obviously a point that's worthy of note. And we would work in collaboration with our colleagues at Trading Standards in that regard.
Thanks very much. David, I don't know if you want to come in back in on that.
Well, yes, certainly echo that last point. We work very close with the police on these things and the customs authorities and so on. We do have quite a significant role in the commercial import of products, and certainly products that have a high safety element to them are top priority. The other point I wanted to make actually about this is in relation to import as well. As we see it at the moment, we're doing some work on this, as I say, on the provisions that have already come in on fireworks, in terms of them being supplied to Scottish consumers from businesses elsewhere in the UK. And we certainly take view that, if given that a lot of the wording around offences and so on in the existing legislation and in the bill as well talks about supply, you know, that seems fairly clear to us that there is a locus in Scotland, you know, for a sale that's come from somewhere elsewhere in the UK. It's being supplied to a consumer. Let's say it's bought online and it's supplied to their house or wherever. So we think that's probably covered by the legislation. And we have been discussing this with colleagues in England and Wales in terms of, you know, them engaging with the businesses local to them that sell fireworks. So the point was, there's a variety of points to this. We want the legislation to work for consumers in Scotland, but we also don't want Scottish businesses to be disadvantaged by you know, businesses from elsewhere in the UK being able to sell to Scottish consumers in a advantageous way. You know, if you see my point on that. So we're really keen on that, that this works properly for consumers as it's intended in the bill, but also that Scottish businesses are not disadvantaged. So quite a bit of work going on that, but again, we see potential there.
Thanks, David. Yeah, no, the important kind of points just to bear in mind there. So thanks very much for that. Pauline, I don't know if you want to just come in at this point.
I mean, it's kind of further thoughts on how easy it is going to be to enforce a licensing scheme with further restrictions on sale and so on, and the types of fireworks that you can buy. I wonder if I could ask again Chief Inspector Nicola Robison about, so there's been many incidents of celebration of football matches or football results and other events where fireworks have been used, perhaps to give you whether it's antisocial behaviour or not. But I just wondered if you thought, in order to make the scheme work, and this is up against the view that some people have on a complete ban, and that's where the context, this is the context where I'm coming from, we need to make the legislation work. But would that mean, in your view, that we do need to have some robust reporting around fireworks, whether they're for antisocial behaviour or not, which are used out with those periods? Or would the Police Scotland take a view that it's not worth pursuing, if you see where I'm coming from? If to make the scheme work, and people are allowed on 37 days of the year, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, the days where people use fireworks out with those days, therefore, to me, seem to have to be prosecuted then. I wonder if you... Because I think probably going off illegally, actually, all the time. We've all heard them when there's been various victories, certainly in my city, it's true. And I mean, I know I'm slightly going off on a tangent here in a sense, but some of the responses from the public, particularly around telling pet owners of Footjai and one that those times when fireworks are going off, that you should just train your animals, obviously clearly don't know anything about what it is like to try and protect an animal who is frightened, or a child with autism, which we heard in the last So I take the view that fireworks going off out with, even if they're not antisocial, should still be dealt with. And I just wondered if that's Police Scotland's view or not. Thank you.
Absolutely. Obviously, we'd encourage communities to make us aware of these incidents of people obviously not adhering to the legislation. Again, I would go back to that we would hope that we can, through this legislation, that it will support a culture change with people recognising the impacts and dangers that fireworks and pyrotechnics can pose, and thereby obviously encouraging that responsible use of fireworks through organised events or obviously through the licensing system. So we would hope through that good communication and obviously communication strategy that will be in place, multi-agency approach, that the public will be fully aware of the legislation and thereby encouraged to adhere to it. But absolutely, from a circumstance basis, if there are issues still within communities, we need to know about it, and then we can obviously target an appropriate response to that individual or persons involved.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks very much. I think Rona Mackay wants to come in on this, and then I'd like to move on to some questions around fireworks control zones. So, Rona.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a brief one. It just occurred to me that in my area, there is a firework pop-up shop which appears every year around about October, I think it is, and then disappears again, you know, after the 5th of November. I'm just wondering how that kind of thing would be affected. I'm thinking to ask David on this, in terms of, you know, is that still viable for that to happen in terms of when, you know, people can buy fireworks and things, or has that been sort of just these temporary units that pop up and then disappear?
David, you want to come in on that?
Sorry,
David, would you like to come in on that?
Yes, yeah, sorry, yes. I think presumably that kind of business could still operate and they could sell during the proposed limited periods, which probably is all they sell at the moment anyway, actually, because the way this works at the moment is there's two types of license essentially. Most businesses, most supermarkets, most small shops and so on that sell fireworks only do so during certain limited periods, and there are a relatively small number of businesses who specialise in fireworks and sell them all year round and need a different authorisation and a different licence for that. So these kind of pop-up shops presumably could continue. They would need to get the licences to store and to supply during that period, and you know, the local authority trading standards would look carefully at a business like that if it's appearing out of the blue or whatever. It's a new license application, you know, and that would be given, you know, quite a lot of attention because, obviously, again, as we said all along, you know, safe storage and supply of fireworks is paramount for public safety and so on. So I don't see why that couldn't continue, continue to operate, I think.
Thanks. Thank you, Convener. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks very much. I'm going to move us on to control zones. We've got a wee bit to get through. We'd also like to cover some questions around pyrotechnics and the financial implications. So I'm going to bring in Colette Stevenson first. So Colette, over to you.
Okay, thanks, Convener, and good afternoon to our panel. You've kind of sort of alluded to Nicola a wee bit in terms of the control zones. I think this question I'm going to pose to Julie because it's more relevant here in terms of local authority. But during the committee's recent visit to Blackburn, some of the community representatives did raise some concerns about how the firework control zones would actually be managed and safely managed at that. And obviously there was some, you know, concerns over unintended consequences, such as acting as a potential attraction for those who want to use fireworks to, you know, obviously generate confrontation, which they've experienced in the past there. With the police and the fire services as well. So basically, again, concerns about, you know, a focus on the zones to the detriment as well of other areas and potential displacement as well of the misuse of fireworks as well. So it was really just to sort of gather your views on that and how you envisage that they actually work those zones in practice.
Thank you. I think, as has been mentioned already, I think that the firework control zones would work only as part of a suite of measures. So in terms of looking at the requirement for a licence, the requirement to pay a fee, the restrictions on when fireworks can be purchased and used, then firework control zones would come in as part of the suite of measures. The Council in principle is supportive of firework control zones, providing that there's robust evidence and clear systems in place to enable key partners and, importantly, the communities to be able to have the say. I suppose one of our concerns is that if there's the ability to apply firework control zones, then we can foresee that there will be many members of the community who will apply to have a firework control zone applied in their particular community. So our view is that there needs to be very clear criteria and it needs to be based on evidence. But the view of the Council is that that approach would allow the communication that was mentioned earlier on, the awareness raising and the planning for the likes of Bonfire Night by community safety partners. And that's not just in terms of planning to deal with antisocial behaviour in those events, but it's also about planning diversionary events. So potentially, I think that during the visit to Blackburn, it was the park and the skate park that were mentioned. So, you know, potentially there's the opportunity to put on diversionary events there to avoid these areas being used. Obviously, there is the danger of diverting the activity to other areas, but I think if the firework control zones are well publicised, then community planning partners again, or community safety partners again, have the opportunity to plan for the particular times when fireworks can be used and to look at how any diversionary activity can support potentially fireworks being used in different areas. So yes, in principle we support it, but part of the larger suite of measures which would be in place.
So I suppose just on that then, really, if, for instance, if you look at East Kilbride, which is the constituency that I cover, I mean, if you look at the demographics here, for instance, so 60% of our population here in East Kilbride are over 50. In terms of control zones, would it be a case of that would be a permanent control zone, or would you look at areas in your data gathering in terms of changing it per year? There could be a new housing estate area. How do you envisage that's going to be in terms of, I know you're obviously commenting on behalf of West Lothian, but it'd be interesting to see just exactly how you envisage you take that forward as well.
I think there would be members of the community who would wish to see that as a permanent arrangement. However, on the basis that our view is that it should be should rely on robust evidence and intelligence and data gathering, I would suggest that there would need to be a review of any firework control zones that were implemented, and that should be for a period of time with a requirement to review and to reassess the intelligence and the evidence around that, which would obviously need to take into account any other areas in the community which were being used or where the misuse of fireworks were applying. I would say that one of the things that we have found most important in the Blackburn area is the community support for the Blackburn group and the approach that the community has to raising awareness of issues in relation to antisocial behaviour around fireworks. So again, as part of the suite of measures, the awareness raising and the communication would be very, very important to make sure that there was community support for firework control zones.
Okay, thanks very much. I suppose as well that the actual bill itself, the intention is that the introduction of firework control zones will help to prevent high levels of unpredictable, you know, firework use as well. Do you see that those zones contributing towards that, the misuse of them? And I suppose my question there is to Nicola, really, in terms of how, you know, policing that as well.
Absolutely, that would have an impact on Police Scotland in respect of resources dependent on the size, location and duration of those zones. However, obviously, we are supportive in respect of it does empower the local communities. Obviously, the engagement with the local authorities would be on the back of the community concerns. Obviously, from our own point of view, as long as those concerns were proportionate to the size and location and duration of that zone. But this would obviously give us another kind of enforcement tool as well, working alongside the kind of licensing system to reduce the antisocial behaviour, obviously affected by the misuse of fireworks. So I think we would just welcome as well, because that engagement is going to be with the local authorities and local communities, we would also welcome the consultation involving ourselves and other colleagues, perhaps Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, in respect of that consultation as to the size and duration and location of those fireworks control zones.
Nicola, do you not see this as more a kind of reactive response, the control zones, rather than being proactive?
No, absolutely. We would welcome any opportunity where we can obviously get an extra prevention opportunities with the public, obviously, to ensure public safety. And again, this would not just be looking at the firework control zones on their own entity. It would complement, obviously, alongside the licensing system and the other elements of the bill. So I think that's really important, certainly from a Police Scotland perspective. It's not just one aspect that we would focus on. It's about that collective response.
Okay, thanks. I don't know if David's got anything he wants to add to that in terms of the control zones.
We're kind of on the periphery of this issue, to be honest, but just a couple of observations I would make is in terms of there is a lot to think about with this. You know, a lot of the antisocial behaviours thought to be in urban areas, and I think it is, but you know, there are rural issues too in terms of fireworks, and that leads on to my other issue in terms of, you know, whatever happens, it needs to be very clearly defined. You know, what is the geographical area, and that might be a few streets in a city, or it might be several square miles up my way in the Highlands. And there's quite a lot of more work, I think, good needs to go into that, as say, our interest would be in as to how the fireworks are supplied and how that interacts. So quite a bit more work to be done, I think, on some of the details there.
Okay, thanks very much. I've got no further questions. Thanks. Thanks, convener.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'd like to keep things moving. We are just about at 3:30, but if I may, I would like to just carry on for around about another 10 minutes or so. I think it's important that we look at some more questions around, in particular, pyrotechnics, and I'll bring in Russell Finlay on that. Before I do that, I wonder if I can maybe just ask, and this is probably one for Chief Inspector Robertson, and that is in relation to our visit to Blackburn just last week there, and one of the things that members of the group raised with us was their experience of promoting use of the Crime Stoppers line as an option for community members reporting issues, in particular with illegal fireworks, reporting that in anonymously if they were worried perhaps about being identified and so on. So I'm just interested in your thoughts on that, I suppose, community sort of messaging, if you like, as an option where people want to report, but they're a bit anxious about doing it. I'll maybe bring you in, Chief Inspector Robertson.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's something that could be potentially flexible depending on each local area as to the communities within that area. Obviously, there are the options for issues to be raised through likes of community councils and through pop-up events with community policing officers, which obviously we would always encourage But if there was an aspect in relation to anonymity, then absolutely Crime Stoppers would be an option. But I think that would be something that would be looked at with a flexible approach as to each local community and how it would be best to serve their concerns and issues. But certainly platforms like community councils, I would certainly encourage for those to be put through.
That's really helpful. Thanks very much for that. Okay, I'll bring in Russell Finlay just to pick up some questioning on pyrotechnics. Russell.
Thank you. And this is a question for Chief Inspector Robertson. Pyrotechnics, as we know, have become increasingly common in the likes of football grounds in recent years. And according to the Scottish Police Federation, the way in which the legislation is currently drafted, they describe it as being convoluted. Specifically, they say that rather than the law allowing for pyrotechnics in certain circumstances, there should be a blanket ban without reasonable excuse. The way they put it is they're not running about the countryside arresting people up mountains or going to marinas and arresting people in possession of flares because they've got a reasonable excuse. Do you agree with the Federation that the legislation as drafted is flawed? And are you, like them, also speaking to Scottish Government about that?
With the legislation that proposed, certainly we would welcome that additional tool to our toolkit in respect of the enforcement and prevention opportunities, particularly around pyrotechnic use of going to football events and other events, because at the moment, although we do have existing legislation that can be used to enforce pyrotechnics, that's generally at the attendance at the event or within the event grounds. And of course, we have identified that issue and trend of the use of pyrotechnics outside the grounds, which obviously I do have a few stats that I could give you today, but certainly we would support the additional powers that are being proposed so that we can, it's earlier intervention and prevention opportunities prior to people getting to an event, but obviously that would be completely proportionate and intelligence and evidence led.
Okay, so just to clarify, you favour the legislation as currently drafted, so the provision of stopping people if they're going to a particular event. But what the Federation are saying is this creates a problem and opens the door to, I think they describe it as a defence lawyer's dream, and it would be more sensible and more workable to have a blanket ban anywhere in possession of pyrotechnics without with the defence of a reasonable excuse. Do you think the Federation's correct? Do you think are Police Scotland seeking clarification or that similar change with Scottish Government?
I think absolutely we would be working with the Police Federation and obviously not digressing from their opinion, but working together in respect of looking at all aspects of the pyrotechnics legislation that's proposed. We do have obviously a number of comments in respect of the general pyrotechnics aspects of it, and a lot of the evidence is coming from that report that certainly you've got sight of in respect of that generally we would favour any additional tools that would help us deal with the possession of pyrotechnics, particularly going to events.
So just to be clear, you clearly back what's proposed, as in the provision relating to going to events. But to extend it, potentially that's something you would presumably talk to Scottish Government and indeed the Federation about?
Absolutely. And even in respect of that clarity of travelling to an event, obviously what the interpretation would be of that, and in relation to likes of the approach of assemblies and on what happens if the 20th person, obviously if you've got a group of persons, we need to then work through as to how that would differ. But that we are in the process of obviously having engagement with Scottish Government and other partners as to how we would work through that.
Thank you, Chief Inspector. And that's me, Convener, and we're short of time.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to come back to you, actually, Russell. I don't know if you have some questions around finance and funding. I'm aware that you covered that to a certain extent earlier on, just to check if there's anything further that you'd like to pick up on that.
I know David did touch on it, but I wonder whether our other witness could perhaps give any indication as to what the financial implications would be for local authorities. Has that been calculated? across the board by COSLA, or is it a work in progress?
I think, convener, it's fair to say that's a work in progress. There has been some consideration given to what resources would be required, and that would certainly, we would require resource around analysis of the data, the consultation that would be required with the communities, and the publicity and awareness of any processes, and also resources to manage any licensing scheme or process that would be in place. But again, the cost around that is still a work in progress.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thanks very much. David, I think you would like to come in on this.
Yes, just very quickly, I talked about some of this earlier, and I think it is different to calculate what the trading standards costs are is easier to do, I think. And because we did this work in 21-22, we'll obviously be analysing that very carefully with Scottish Government as to, you know, that in terms of our other calculations, that we should be able to come up with clear figures, which we've already kind of done, but they'll also be finessed a bit on the basis of the experience of this year. So that is a separate thing. I think it's much more difficult, what Julie talked about, it's much more difficult to calculate. I think that's very much a work in progress. But just to make that point, that our calculations, I think, are a bit easier to make within the overall context that I talked about earlier about us being gone.
Thanks very much, David. I think that's maybe sort of brought out in your written submission, so that's helpful just to reiterate that point. Thank you very much. Oh, I think maybe Chief Inspector Robertson, you'd like to come in.
Yes, thank you. It was just obviously a recap of the question I was just asked there, just to provide some information additionally to that. So Free Scotland's own short life working group that was pulled together in respect of pyrotechnics identified the potential benefits of a simple possession offence in relation to pyrotechnics with a lawful authority and reasonable excuse clause to permit legitimate users to conduct their activities. So this is a legislative format that's well established in other contexts and with which officers obviously at the moment are currently familiar. So it's appreciated that the bill is intended to provide a proportionate response to these issues, including the evidence obviously available from ourselves. But the more limited offence under Section 33 in relation to pyrotechnics at specific types of events does present a practical and evidential challenge obviously for ourselves. So from a Police Scotland perspective, if the bill isn't amended to introduce a broader, simpler possession offence, it's essential that the provisions are passed, including those for any subordinate regulations or orders are capable of being amended to address issues that may be occurred in the future. If that could be something that could be considered, that would obviously be appreciated. And just a final point, in relation to the evidencing that an article is indeed a pyrotechnic article, in terms of this offence, it would be helpful to have a presumption of contents clause in the bill. And the Pyrotechnics Article Safety Regulations 2015 require legitimate pyrotechnics to be categorised by manufacturers and collectively labelled, amongst other things, the name, type and category of article. A presumption of contents clause would offer a simple kind of mechanism for evidencing the nature of these articles. And it's appreciated, obviously, homemade or illegal imported articles may not be correctly labelled, and these may require full scientific examination to determine their nature. But this process involves articles being transported in person by officers to a specialist laboratory in England and is costly, obviously, in terms of officer time, and places an additional burden on specialist scientists and could slow the progress of potential criminal cases. So in the absence of a presumptive of contents clause, there could be a requirement to submit all pyrotechnics articles for such examination in order to prove an offence under Section 33. And if this could be avoided for a significant proportion of such articles, then that would obviously be welcomed by ourselves as well, convener.
But thanks very much, Chief Inspector. That's a helpful overview. I don't know if Russell, if you would like to just come back in on that from Nicola.
Indeed, thank you. I think this is where I was going with the questioning earlier, and it sounds like a lawyer has perhaps written quite a lengthy answer, which boils down to the preference for an absolute ban on possession, if indeed that's workable, with the defence of reasonable grounds to have them. Is that my understanding of, sorry, is my understanding of what you just read out there correct?
Yes, obviously we had sought advice through our legal representation as well on aspects of the bill, whereby obviously we did recognise that currently there's no possession offence or police search power in respect of the type of pyrotechnics that are generally seen at events in Scotland, except obviously provided by the Criminal Law Consolidation Scotland Act. But we have looked at that and identified that there are potential issues that we would need to work through in respect of this bill.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. If that is all the questions that members have, then we have overrun it, so I'll just bring the session to a close. Obviously, if our panel members today feel that there's any outstanding points that they would like to follow up with us, then please feel free to do that in writing and we'll be happy to take your evidence into account. So again, my thanks to our witnesses for attending this afternoon. And that now concludes the public part of the meeting. And we'll now move into private session to review the evidence that we've heard today. Thank you very much.